We had Elcomsoft present last year with the CEO Vladimir and Andre, and I emailed them earlier this year asking if they would come back, and they were interested, and then I had to email Vladimir and Andre several times to, you know, I need an abstract, a title, something, who will be coming. And then finally, Andre said to me that he and Vladimir were not able to come, but instead they would send the CTO, Andy, and also Dmitry Sklyarov. And I was like, okay, so they are sending Dmitry. Well, that's not a bad replacement. That was my initial thought. And Dmitry, as I said yesterday, he has been so lucky, he has actually seen the insides of an American prison.
Yeah.
For doing security research. Now, that's not going to be your topic today.
Right.
Yeah, looking at American prisons from inside, but evolution of password verification methods in software. So I'm really, really happy. I think it's really nice that you could come here, both of you. And, well, stage is yours. So good luck.
Thank you. Good afternoon. My name is Dmitry Sklyarov, and here is my colleague Andrei Malyshov, and we are both from Elcomsoft. Probably you knew Elcomsoft is a company most specialized on password recovery software. We produce software to recover forgotten or lost passwords. Maybe someone called it not recovering by cracking, but actually it doesn't matter. It's all the same, it's just words. We are working on this in this area more than 10 years, and I believe we do a really good job in this area. I will try to show some real examples of how some software vendors implement a process of verification of passwords in their products. Passwords could be used for many purposes, and main of them is authentication and data secrecy. So we need to find is password entered by user is correct one, and we could use password to protect something with cryptography. And password could be verified remotely, so when you're trying to log on Windows domain, you type passwords, it's transferred to server, verified on server, and server return you okay or not okay. So it's all on server. And other passwords verified locally. And the last one, local verification, is much more vulnerable because you have access to software that verified it. You could control it, you could reverse engineer it, and so on. So I will speak mostly about passwords that verified locally. And sure, passwords that use it to protect data of some user. People start using passwords maybe at the same time as they start using computer. And there are some evolution of ideas how passwords should be handled for verification properly. At stone age of password verification, we have idea to obfuscate password. So when you set password, it's somewhere hidden inside your hard drive, for example. And during verification, it's deobfuscated, and password strings just check it for match. So it's stupid approach, but like Per said several times, Sony still do it for now. And many other companies and many backdoors implement in such way. So if you have reverse engineering skills, you could just find the password. So it's not protection at all. Next age, so-called bronze age, it's using hash. It's a bright idea because hash function is one way function and you are unable to get passwords from hash values. So you need to test multiple passwords, increment to next one, calculate hash, which is a relatively slow process, and then check if hash stored inside your data is match hash calculated from your own password, from password you're trying to guess. And probably it would take long time to recovering password protected in such way. But there is some threat exists. If you have multiple passwords stored with the same hash, when you're trying to attack such system, you could compare one calculated hash with many hashes stored. And comparison is very fast operation in comparison with hashing. So if you have 1 million of hashes stored, you could just increase attack speed by magnification of 1 million, because comparison is very fast. So to prevent such type of attack, people invent salt, non-secret value that could be used to force attacker try calculating hash for every stored hash, not for all hashes at one attempt. So if your passwords have different cells, you need to test each of them separately. And there is no way to improve it, to change this. But that was very long ago. Now we have computers everywhere, so we are at computer age. And people realize that computers become faster and faster. Hash function initially was designed not for protection of password. It was designed for other purposes, and it's designed as a fast function. So we need repeat hashing multiple times to slow down attack process. All that I said before this point is common sense, and I believe that everyone in this auditorium knew about that for many years. At least I knew about it for 10 years, for example. And I believe that many people all around the world realize how passwords should be handled in sense of these common ideas. So, real life example. Unix hash crypt implemented in 1979. It's very long ago, more than 30 years. There is a short description. They tried to struggle against most of possible attacks. So they use salt, not very long, but Unix at that time was very small, have very small requirements for memory, and they're trying to make all of information and handle as to occupy as many as little space as possible. So only 12 bits, 25 rounds, but they base algorithm of hashing on death. I believe the only well-known cryptographic algorithms at that years, but they modify the algorithms to prevent usage of hardware that exists for death calculation. So they even thinking about struggle against hardware attacks, because it's one of strong way to attack system using hardware. That hash not perfect. It supports only passwords with lengths of 8 or less, so longer password just truncated to 8 characters. But anyway, it's well designed. If we thinking about the year of design, 1979. 10 years later, Microsoft designed the LM hash. I believe I shouldn't speak too much about this hash. It's a story from Bible of security. It's designed as bad as possible. I don't know what we should do with the hash to make it much worse than it already is. 10 years passed after design of Unix hash. Unix source was available, I believe. So they have chance, designers of this hash have chance to get some experience from other people, but they designed their own hash. And you knew it's all bad. 3 years later, they replaced it with anti-LM hash. They removed two problems. They doesn't reduce char set and have support for long passwords, but they still use no salt and they still fast verification algorithms. So it's not perfect again, not as bad as LM hash, but st- still not good, and 3 years give nothing to them. It's a very simple example. After 1993, new threats appeared related with the passwords. First one is rainbow tables. They were introduced in 2003, and actually they were based on an idea from 1988 from Hellman that we could use some pre-computation to make attacks much faster. And that attack is suitable for almost any system that use no salt or that use encryption key without initialization vector. So even if you have only single hash in your system, not multiple hashes, sometimes this idea could help you attack much faster. And another threat is GPU. In 2007, NVIDIA introduced the CUDA that allows programmers to use integer arithmetic to develop their own code that run on GPU. And GPU is a single instruction, multiple data. It's a parallel computer. And using it properly allows you to run some integer arithmetic operations much faster than general central processing queue. It's not suitable for every algorithm. Mostly it's well for algorithms with a lot of mathematical operations like additions, multiplications, but not too good for algorithms that requires a lot of memory access, like RC4 stream cipher. But GPU allows you to get advantages of hardware without paying for that hardware, because for many computers, GPU is a built-in system, so you don't have to pay for it. And now some evolution of passwords implemented by Microsoft Office, Word and Excel for many, many different versions. Versions prior to Office 97, they use encryption, they called it encryption. Password actually was transformed to 16 bytes gamma, and the gamma was repeatedly XORed with all data of document. So simple statistical analysis allows you to recover gamma, and algorithms calculating gamma was reversible, invertible, so you was able to get password. Actually, if you have gamma, you don't need to have password. You have access to data already, so you knew the content of the document, so password doesn't matter in this situation. And by the way, Claude Shannon published his paper in 1979, and I believe after that paper, there is entropy of information was appeared in mathematics, and I believe that from 39 to 70 to 97, it's enough time to realize that XOR is not a good encryption. You need something stronger. Next attempt to protect documents was made in Office 97, and until Office 2003, they use modern algorithms, MD5, RC4, but according to United States government limitation for export cryptographic algorithms, they obey to law, and they use only 40 bits encryption. At that time, it seems relatively strong, because a single person was unable to crack it using its own home computer for months, for example. But as I said earlier, computers become faster and faster, and now attack on 40 bits encryption is very fast. So limitation was removed in year 2000. There was only 7 countries that were prohibited from selling software developed in the United States with encryption longer than 128 bits and longer, but Microsoft spent 3 years to adapt the software to support longer keys. And for now, for example, we at Elcomsoft developed so-called standard tables. It's used extended rainbow tables, so rainbow tables plus all keys that not covered by rainbow tables. Rainbow tables are probabilistic one, and there is no 100% guarantee that key you search for is inside your tables. But we have extension and we cover 100% of key space. And using the tables, average key recovery took 3 minutes, and complete key search takes about 10 minutes. For one document. So we could attack 40 bits documents very fast. In Office 2003, Microsoft allowed people to use longer keys, longer encryption keys, and user could have ability to choose 46 or 128 bits encryption using cryptographic service provider. But to change encryption level, you need to go through menu systems, through options, and actually it's not easy way for average user, and most users never change that settings, and I believe that 95% of documents created in all versions of Office that support 128 bits encryption still have 40 bits encryption because user never changed settings. They just set the password. And algorithms of verification was fast enough, use only single iteration, so even not Iron Age. Very, very stupid, I believe. And only in Office 2007, Microsoft introduced multi-iteration hashing, so it allows people to protect their data more secure than before. In Office 2007, Microsoft redesigned the whole system interface, file format, and probably they decided that security is not less important than usability. So they allows people to send new encryption with longer verification of key, but they lost support from previous versions, so you was unable to open new document in old Office. Actually, later than produce compatibility packs, so I still use Office 2003 and I'm able to open new documents with new protection. But now people have chance to protect their document more secure. And in Office 2010, they increased the number of iterations from 50,000 to 100,000, so make process of attacking twice slower. But Microsoft Access it's included in extended version of Office, but it have its own personal security history. So before Access 2007, there was 3 different elements of security for Microsoft Access database. Whole database encryption, database open password, and user-level passwords for the database access. Encryption was managed through database menu system, through access data menu system, and after encrypting document, it had good entropy, so you wasn't able to compress it with any archiver, but to be honest, encrypted or not encrypted database works in the same way. So it's not related with ability to access it. And actually, there was no secret element. Algorithms of calculating encryption key is hard-coded inside database. Key is hard-coded inside database. So there is nothing secret. I don't know what is intention of such protection. This protection exists. Another level of protection, database open password. To protect database from opening by people who should not have right to do so, when you try to open it, access asking you for the password. If you don't know, you knew the password, you're unable to use database at all. But database password just stored in header. It's just verified. It's encrypted by invertible algorithms, so we could decrypt it. And it's very easy to find that password. Database is not encrypted on that password. So you could change passwords without re-encrypting the whole database. And actually, it's very easy to find it. There was one very funny story that at the time I'm not started working for Elcomsoft yet, it's more than 10 years ago, I saw some program for recovering access open database password, and companies that produce that software for new version said that it's 20% faster than earlier. Actually, database password extraction is just XOR. XOR is fixed gamma. Because, again, algorithms RC4 and key is hard-coded in the program. It's all the same for every database created in Access. So you could just calculate gamma once and then just XOR several bytes with that gamma to find the password. In Office 2003, they added another level of protection. So after decrypting header, you need to get some floating point value converted to double word and XOR all words of your protected password with this word value. It's obfuscation, it's not security. So open password could be easily retrieved from database and unable to provide security at all. So if you knew the algorithms, it's very easy to crack. Last level, user level passwords. It's multi-user database, so it's a very good idea to protect your data by access rights. Again, all passwords are encrypted in three DES, actually three DES with two keys. And keys are hard-coded in Access, so they always the same, so you could just decrypt the passwords if you have access to system database that store encrypted passwords. Even not hashing, just encryption that invertible. And actually, every element of database have set of records, ID writes. And system database have ID password. If you don't have system database, you could just get ID from main database and generate new system database with user ID that have rights you need. So ID, I believe that ID is more secret than password. But you could create user with ID you need and have level of access you need. So Access before year 2007 was absolutely insecure. There was no really secret element. Two level of passwords protection and whole database encryption, just nothing. They just doesn't work. In Office 2007, they start using cryptographic service provider, like in other Microsoft Office products, to protect database. So database is protected, but verification is fast. And finally, in 2010, they start using multi-iteration hash with 100,000 iterations, so they get the same level of security like for other Microsoft Office products. So they developed almost in parallel with Word and Excel, but the level of security was much worse than for Word and Excel. I don't know why. Yeah?
the single iteration, is that SHA-1 or?
Actually, there are about five SHA.
So, five, I guess, three or four, don't remember exactly.
So calculation of verification process, about four blocks of SHA-1. It's not repeated many times, like 100,000. It's very fast. Another product I from Microsoft that one customer of our company asked to develop password recovery for was Microsoft Windows Easy Transfer. It's a set of applications that allows you to transfer your user account data from old computer to new one, from Windows XP to Vista or Windows 7. And initially it was developed for Windows XP. I believe 2006 is something near Vista appeared on the market. And here is implementation, password hashed with SHA-1. With SHA-1 again is expanded to 168 bits, algorithm is described in Microsoft documentation. And they have IV block, 8 bytes, encrypted in CBC mode using triple death, and IV and fixed plain text. Plain text is just string that uses for verification the password. And later we have ciphertext block that use it for verifying user password. Actually, 168 bits calculated from 160 bits, that output of SHA-1. So the strongest key is 160 bits. It's long enough for such type of data, so cracking SHA-1 is expensive. I believe I never heard that someone make collision for this, even collision for this hash. So searching this value is not easy. But several words about CBC. I believe that all of you already knew what's it. We have instantiation vector that XORed with plaintext block. And later it's encrypted and ciphertext is available for us. We knew plaintext, we knew ciphertext, but we don't knew IV. So ciphertext depends on key and IV. IV is just random value. It's like salt. So to attack the system, we need to use IV from the document. So we could not build random tables. I explore code on Windows XP, and then I decided to check how it works on Windows 7, because Windows 7 have migration tool too. And I was wondering that instantiation vector is set to zero. So all documents, all easy transfer files, MIG files, migration files, produced in Windows 7 on my computer have instantiation vector zero. Using this idea, you have ability to build rainbow tables on passwords, so every document would be attacked much faster. I believe Windows 7 was developed not so long ago. Another company that...
Yeah. So it used a proper IV in XP and Vista, and then in 7?
I never tried in Vista. Actually, I don't have Vista installation. It's use random IV in XP, so every time you create a file, it's have new value. I not explore random number generator, but I believe they just get data from cryptographic service provider. It's it's random enough. But no, for 7, they just zero it.
It's totally
crazy. I don't know why they did so. Intuit Greeting. Before year 2003, they have weak password protection, but in 2003, they redesigned whole protection and make brute force of passwords very slow process. And also they added, I believe they never documented, but when you reverse engineered, you was able to find that document key, randomly generated key, is encrypted on public key of Intuit and encrypted record written in the database file, in protected file. So if you lost your password, you have chance to contact to Intuit to somehow ensure them that it's your data, and they give you opportunity to decrypt your document using that recovery record. In the year 2008, we at Elcomsoft just factored 512-bit RSA key and get ability to decrypt that record without sending something to Intuit. So this led to absolutely zero level of protection for all documents with such approach. By the way, RSA 512 bits was first cracked in 1999, so for 4 years before designing of such weak protection. I don't know why people who implement something just not look back. Probably they just look forward for too far. Another Microsoft product, encrypted file system. It was introduced in Windows 2000 to protect user data. So it's a complex schema. We have multiple of items here. Password entered by user, hashed somehow. So after that, we obtain certificate key. Certificate is stored in file system. We decrypt it using that key, and it's symmetric encryption, and get our RSA private key. Using that private key, we decrypt file key, the type to key, and content symmetric file key encrypted on public key of every user that have access to that document, to that file. So it's a hybrid system of encryption. We decrypt asymmetrically file key that tied to my user account, and using this file key we able to decrypt file data that's stored in encrypted form. You knew that it's common approach to protecting data, even if you have administrative right but don't have right to this file, you're unable to get content of it, even if you have full access to that system. It's encryption. But at first implementation of EFS, Microsoft made little failure. They used the same hash as for security accounts manager, as for some database. So you don't need to know the password. If you have physical access to computer, you just extract password hash from some database and insert it in this point. You don't need password. You could decrypt all files for all users, if you have administrative rights to get some database access.
They use the layman or the NT hash?
They use NT hash, and in next in service pack, they just changed this hash. So they have different hashes, and now it doesn't work. But people who implement so complex system just doesn't think that they already have that hash in system in open form. It's obfuscated, but it's available. Now my favorite. PDF. Initial version of PDF was PDF format was 1.0, and I believe that there was no encryption at all. Before PDF 1.7, to transfer from PDF version to Acrobat version, you need just add one to last digit. So 1.1 is Acrobat 2, 1.6 is Acrobat 7. So in PDF specification 1.1, Adobe introduced document content encryption based on password. They use, again, industry standards, MD5, RC4, good algorithms at that years, and they use the same key for all objects. So it's stream cipher, and if you have one object decrypted, you could calculate gamma and decrypt all other objects. So you have very good chances for the statistical attacks, and it's bad approach. They first fixed it, and in the same year they have new specification for Acrobat 3, and every object have,
If you have the same keys, same string cipher for everything, instead of doing statistical attack, couldn't you just make a document that you knew would have lots of zeros, for example, and read off the key there?
A content of document produced not by you, but the acrobat. You need some plain text, but most of objects inside documents are compressed, so you need to get plain text in compressed data, and it's not too easy. But you have, actually, I believe that it could be attacked if you have several...
If you put in a compressed image that you already knew the compression for, you could read off just by XORing, you could get the stream, right?
You need to get the stream, but if you don't know the image content, you don't have plain text. You need to have plain text from some source.
You're making the document, so you could put an image and it's not
We are talking about attacking my own documents
or
some other documents.
The same
document.
For every document, so I assume you could make your own document just to read off the stream. You could read off the key by making your own document with known...
No.
Different key.
Every document have different keys, but gamma is the same for all objects. So multiple
in the same document.
Yeah, right.
Oh, I see.
Multiple objects encrypted with the same gamma.
Okay.
So you have multiple gamma applications, but you don't know the gamma.
I misunderstood you when you said multiple objects. All the files were the same.
PDF document is a set of objects.
I understand. Okay.
So in a new edition, they just added one more level of key calculations. And now, from document key, Acrobat derive object key that depends on object ID, and different objects use different gamma, so it's more secure. But again, it's 1996, cryptographic restriction of US government, and they use RC4 with 40 bits. They have fast calculations, one MD5 block hashing, and one RC4, actually 32 bytes of RC4 encrypted, but to encrypt first byte you need to set key, and it's time consuming, like 256 bytes encryption. So it's one RC4 calculation, it's near time to set the key. So after that process, you knew is your key right or not. So is your password correct or not? So it's fast, and again we have Thunder tables built for PDF documents that allows you in minutes to find 40 bits encryption key for any document. In PDF 1.4. Adobe introduced support for longer keys. It's after year 2000. No strong cryptographic expert restriction exists. They slowed down process about 40 times. They use different numbers because RC4 is slower than MD5, so they balance time spent for MD5 and RC4. And in PDF 1.6, they introduced IS encryption instead of RC4. I don't think that it's significant improvements, because 128 bits key is much more important. But now it is. And if you have really long password with good char set, it's very hard to crack that protection. It's may consider it to be almost strong. Version 1.7 appeared in 2006. Next version, it's related to Acrobat 9. In Acrobat 9, engineers from Adobe decided to get top level of security using top level security primitives. They use 256 bits encryption with IES, and they use new hash, SHA-2056, instead of combination of MD5 and RC4. It looks like improvement in security, but they use single iteration, so single SHA-2056 calculation to verify the password. And as I said earlier, RC4 is not too good for GPU implementation because it requires a lot of memory access. But SHA-2056 is very good for GPU. So even without GPU, we have attack speed like in 1996 algorithm. But with GPU, we could improve it 10 times, make it 10 times faster. So in year 2008, Adobe stepped back for 10 years. I don't know why. And finally, in Acrobat X, Acrobat version 10, they use new design. I think it's paranoid design to prevent GPU acceleration. They have multi-iteration hashing. Number of iterations, at least 64, and up to 287. And it's dynamically chosen during hash process. So when you start hashing, when you start calculating all this stuff, you don't know how many iterations it would require. On every iteration, there are one of these three algorithms is chosen to hash data. Using parallel computation on GPU, all your virtual processor either performs the same operations or do nothing. So you could not do SHA-2056 on one processor and SHA-384 on another one. One of them works, all others do nothing. So this approach makes almost impossible to implement attack using GPU. So it's well designed, but I believe it's really paranoid design. Actually, it's a good idea to prevent GPU acceleration. Who knows, maybe it's the future of password protection. Also, there is a kind of industry standard appears in handling passwords for data secrecy. PBKDF, Password Based Key Derivation Function version 2. It's meta algorithms that could be used in conjunction with different hash function with a different number of rounds, and developer free to choose which settings use. Most common implementation use SHA-1 algorithm as hash function, and the number of rounds is just parameter for calling PBKDF2 function. In iTunes for iOS 3.x devices, number of iterations was chosen 2000. It's not too many, so verification process is relatively fast, but it's not one, not 10. In next version, they increase this amount 5 times. BlackBerry, smartphone developer research in motion, actually they considered to be a good company in security. And in modern version, there is 20,000, 2 times more than for iTunes. What do you think the value here? Right, one. So we use industry standard. Number doesn't matter.
You're still compliant because you're using an industry standard, right?
Yeah, right. BitLocker to go. It's a BitLocker version from Windows 7 that developed to encrypt flash drives. There are many ways to protect your flash drives. TPM certificates on tokens and passwords. What's the numbers here?
Microsoft will probably won't.
No. 1 million.
Oh.
Verification of these passwords took 2 seconds. One password in 2 seconds on the average computer. It could speed it up with GPU because it's SHA. It's good with GPU, but it's paranoid too. So different vendors choose different values and speed difference in 1 million times. So it's about 3 characters. And here the shortest password is 8 characters. It's security limitation. You couldn't set password shorter than 8 characters. 8 characters, 2 seconds per password, even short word list would take long time. Long word list like you use for your presentation would take months using this speed of password verification. So Microsoft sometimes choose good security settings too. And last several words about iOS 4 devices, about passcode verification. There are several publications during last months, one on the Hack in the Box conference and another one from our company. We developed acquisition tool for forensics needs to get data from iOS 4 devices. We cover all devices except iPad 2. It's the most secure device from Apple because there is no jailbreak for it. Probably yet, probably, I don't know. We use ideas and tools from other guys who developed jailbreak, tether jailbreak, to get access to the phone. And then we run our code to perform acquisition tests to extract secrets that necessary for working with iPhone, for extracting for searching for passcode. Passcode is protected by hardware IDs. It's use key that unique for every phone. I believe Apple could have some database that sets relation between phone body number and encryption key, but it's not available to anyone outside Apple. So if you have phone, the only way to search for passcode is run code on the phone. You could not extract some data for offline attack. And you need to use this implementation. It's use 50,000 of blocks encryption for verifying of one passcode. And there are 4 types of passcode, no passcode, empty passcode, 4 digits, classical passcode, any number of digits except 4. So you have only digits keypad, but not for places for digits. And arbitrary passcode with just this full keyboard enabled. And testing speed is depends from device model. For iPhone 3GS, it's 2.7 passwords per second. For iPad, the fastest device is 6.8 passwords. For iPhone 3GS, brute force for 4-digit passcode took about a couple of hours with access to the phone. So you need to connect to phone, make tether jailbreak, run our software on it, and that software will try all possible combinations in 2 hours. So after 2 hours, you will get secret that allows you to decrypt some files on file system. That files are unavailable until you enter correct passcode. It's good implementation. I like how Apple handles security in the iOS line of products. So it's...
So how do you check that the tested password is okay? Do you actually have to decrypt the file or do you have a simpler API call to test?
Actually, Speaking about iPhone and iOS security could took several hours, actually. I could just lead you to presentation from guys at Hack in the Box. There is some information available. There are multiple level of security, and there is so-called keybag that's stored on file system, and that keybag is encrypted itself by some other key, so-called EMF. I will remember later the name of that key. I just answer. And there are many records, and every record contains key enveloped with standard IS enveloped function. It's implemented in OpenSSL, for example. And you provide a key that you get from passcode, calculates from passcode using this multi-iteration algorithms, to unwrap function, and unwrap function return success or fail, and this is a way to check if your passcode is correct one or not.
When you said 2 to 3 hours, is that if someone uses the four number passcode?
Yeah, for 2 hours for four digit passcode. If you use arbitrary passcode, it's only dictionary attack applicable, because actually, you could check 2 or 3 characters, but if you use even 8 characters with digits and numbers, digits and letters, it's almost impossible to crack in reasonable time. It takes weeks or months working with your iPhone, and you couldn't speed up it with using multiple computers. It's all on the device. Yeah, most people use 4 digits, right? And it could be attacked and crack it during 2 hours. And for iPad 1, it could be cracked in 30 minutes. So I believe that's all that I was ready to deliver to you today. Thanks for your attention, and thanks, Per, for invitation.
Yep. Questions for Dmitry?
I was wondering, do you have any more details on why you have to use the device? Is it, you said that it's AES and it's implemented. Is it, have they shifted around the algorithm?
No, it's plain. It's plain AES. If you search internet about keys and encryption in the phone, in iPhone, you will find that there are 2 keys inside every device from Apple. One of them is model key. It's shared between all devices of the same model, but different for other models. That key used for decrypting part of firmware during update or something like that. And another key is unique key for each device, for every device. So all that process performed on keys that unique for the device. I don't know how strong that implementation. Apple use microprocessor from Samsung, I believe. That is ARM processor with some extension. Extension publicly not available, no details. It's a custom processor developed only for Apple. You couldn't buy it just on the market. And IS implementation inside it, I believe it's less secure than in smart card, but it's secure enough to prevent you from extracting the key for $10. I believe it's $10,000 or more.
So the device key, do they actually, does it seem to be that they did a good job at, you know, making a randomly generated key? Like, has anyone seen any patterns in the, like, serial number or anything like that?
Actually, nobody knew device key. It's impossible to extract it. You could run IS over it. So you could put data on input and get output, but you don't have access to key. If access to key would be available,
yeah,
this could be performed on powerful PC.
Yeah,
for the products for which you have developed the rainbow table or thunder table and so on, do you sell something that users can track their own documents with, or do you sell a network service that they have to send the thing to you? Because these tables are going to be very big, right?
Yeah. For now, we don't have service. We offer several versions of our product, and the only enterprise version use standard tables. So common version, home or professional one, are available for download, and full version delivered on the DVD. But you shouldn't run it from DVD, you should copy it to flash drive, because DVD random access time is very bad. It would take hours using DVD, but with flash drive it's less than 2 minutes per document, in average.
Okay, well, thank you, Dmitry.
Thank you.